Sorry, Brad.
Welcome to another edition of Studio One and another season of Studio One. I'm Chris Kerwin, along with Kim Fisher, Jennifer Vandergon, and Brad Schumacher. All new faces for you this year, except for Brad. He's our veteran weather forecaster. And coming up April 23rd, our 100th show. This is my first, but it's hard to believe Studio One's already done 100 shows on April 23rd.
Yeah, we got a lot to live up to.
Yeah.
We've got a lot of things planned for the 100th show, too.
That should be a big show, but we got a big show right now. Is there a connection between heavy drinking and the transmission of the HIV virus? Dr. David Hunnicut thinks so. In our second half hour, he'll show us what he believes to be a lethal link between AIDS and alcohol.
Also in our second half hour, we'll celebrate Black Culture Month with Black Student Association President Olga James and take a closer look at some of thy diverse multicultural issues.
All that plus UND's winningest women's basketball coach ever, Jean Roebuck, on the way for you. But first, Jennifer's in with the news headlines.
Thanks, Chris. President Clinton and his traveling cabinet coming to a town near you. The new administration is fanning out across the country to pitch Clinton's $493 billion economic package. The president will spend the day in Ohio and New York before heading to California this weekend. He got a warm reception in St. Louis yesterday. He told a flag-waving crowd his plan serves the national interest. Nearly 3,000 more U.S. troops in Somalia will begin going home next week. A military spokesman says the withdrawal will reduce the U.S. presence to about 15,000 troops. That's down from almost 25,000 troops last month. Boeing plans to cut 27,000 jobs by the middle of next year. The world's largest airplane maker blames declining production for the layoffs. Boeing says the cuts equal almost 20% of its workforce. They will be handled by resignations, retirements, and layoffs. Boeing says it will eliminate nearly 22,000 jobs this year, including 15,000 in Puget Sound and 6,000 in Wichita, Kansas. The University of North Dakota's addition at the North Medical Building is getting bigger. The university received a $350,000 challenge grant from the Kresge Foundation. UND officials say they need to raise $650,000 by July to meet the challenge. They're confident they can do it.
We're going to meet this. It'll be realized. And what a magnificent happening for this community, for the state of North Dakota, and for this region.
Last fall, construction started for a separate $9 million addition. When both additions are done, the medical school should look like this model. The newest addition will house a library, auditorium, lecture halls, and teaching labs. Construction is expected to start this spring. Parents often dream of their children being excited about learning. Now with new technology, this dream is becoming reality. Reporter Heather Murphy tells us more.
From the invention of the radio to the invention of the computer, technology has constantly been advancing. Now we are being introduced to interactive video.
A lot of the interactive features will be educational based. It will give you a number of options and you'll decide which direction you want to take, and it will involve music and moving pictures as well as still pictures and information.
Not only is video technology being shown in the stores, it is also being used in local schools.
What he did in his presidency, the election, the legislators.
To care for him who shall have borne the battle, and for his widow and his orphan.
One really important thing with multimedia is that it really is interactive, where the students, you know, are in control of what they're putting together.
Teachers also say that they have seen an improvement in children's grades due to the multimedia equipment.
Because they want to do it. It's not procrastinate, put it off. Put it off, put it off. Now it's, when can I go do it? Every day they ask me, can I go down to the library and use the girl ears for my inventor report or for my survival guide report?
Currently, the school only has two software programs, the Grolier Electronic Encyclopedia and a Visual Almanac, but they have hopes of getting more.
Within the library, I'm hoping that we will get more research tools on CD-ROM, Bartlett's Familiar Quotations, there are animal encyclopedias, a lot of other things that way.
Teachers say technology is here to stay, and students are now being given the opportunity to learn all they can about it. With photographer Mary Lizakowski, I'm reporter Heather Murphy, Studio One News.
A video disc player costs approximately $600, while the software runs about $300. Many schools are using technology to help educate, but some schools can't afford that technology. Others are having a hard time buying books for their libraries. UND's Chester Fritz Library will not order any more books until June. The director of UND Libraries says demand for books and journals is up. He says the library must finish paying for journal subscriptions before they can afford more books. Subscriptions are costing more every year, and that's eating away at the book budget.
Demands for books is just as high here as it is for journals. The dilemma is that we don't have an infinite budget, we have a finite budget, and so we have to strike a balance.
DeAndrea says the crisis is not unique to UND. He says other academic research libraries at South Dakota State, Montana State, and the University of Manitoba are facing similar budget problems. And he also said that they're looking at other ways to find some money through alumni and grants and some different things to get the books that we need.
Okay, sounds like a good plan. Thanks, Jennifer. Well, is there hope for warmer weather yet? Brad Schumacher joins us now to fill us in on this weekend's weather forecast. Brad?
Thanks, Kim, and welcome to the first show of the season here at Studio One. We're starting off this season with a new segment in weather. It's called Weather Fact. I'll be posing a question and dealing with the answer, or just giving you a fast fact dealing with the weather. Our Weather Fact for this week deals with circular rainbows, and if you can ever see a circular rainbow. Well, for those of you in the know, we'll bring up our version of a circular rainbow. The answer is yes, you can see circular rainbows on a small scale and horizontal surfaces. For example, a dew bow is an example of a circular rainbow forming on the vast expanse of a grass lawn containing heavy dew. So you learn something new every day, I think. But let's turn now toward the current conditions in Grand Forks area. Cloudy skies, temperature of 7 degrees, winds are out of southwest at 5 miles per hour. The wind chill is at 4, and the pressure is falling. Let's turn now toward the significant weather across the nation, happening mostly on the west coast. This low pressure system is responsible for bringing down some snow showers and actually heavy snow amounts in parts of Nevada and Colorado. Colorado Rockies and the Sierras could see as much as a foot of snow there today. Let's turn now toward the high temperatures across the nation. You'll see 50s and 60s in the southern parts of the nation, while 30s and 40s in the middle parts. We'll zoom into our area, the tri-state area, and you'll see the teens and possibly in the single digits in Minnesota and North Dakota. The current temperatures across the tri-state area, well, you'll see a negative 16 in International Falls and 11, the warm spot there this morning at Bismarck. What does all this mean for us? Well, our forecast calls for cloudy skies, a chance of flurries later on in the day, a high of 15 degrees and the wind chill at negative 16. Tonight, the clouds and the flurries should stay with us. Lows right around zero. We may dip below zero later on tonight. And the wind chill, negative 25. The winds will be coming out of the north at 5 to 15 miles per hour. Our extended outlook, mostly cloudy skies on through the weekend, on into Monday. And the temperatures, as you can tell, 13 Saturday, decreasing to around 6 by Monday. But hold on, don't give up yet, because Chris and Kim, we can't stay in this rut for long.
Thanks, Brad. Well, Chris, if anything, hockey players will be happy to hear about the cold weather.
Outdoor hockey players, the rinks will be nice. And I know spring is coming because pitchers and catchers are already reporting to spring training for Major League Baseball, so spring's around the corner. Let's go back to hockey for a second. Minnesota North Stars owner Norm Green says he's lost plenty of green on the NHL club, so he might move the team next year. The newest factor in the equation, the $10 million he says he's lost so far. Green says he wants a guarantee of 10,000 season tickets sold so he can make the team profitable. And that's well over 3,500 short of what he sold this season. Last weekend, the owner said if things don't work out at the Met Center, the star's current home, or somewhere else in Minnesota, he would move the team to the West Coast or even Dallas. Let's go to NHL movement on the ice Thursday. Rich Knickles spent 14 seasons playing minor league hockey before the LA Kings gave him a chance in the big leagues last night. But Jeremy Roenick's two goals helped Chicago spoil the debut as the Blackhawks down the Kings 7-2. In Pittsburgh, the Oilers are visiting the Penguins. Game tied at 4, Esa-Tikkanen uses the slow motion deke to get by two defensemen and goalie Tom Barrasso. That's the game winner. Oilers 5, Penguins 4. Another game-winning highlight for you in the NBA. Portland and LA tied it with 27 seconds left when Terry Porter drives the lane for the game-winning bucket. Trailblazers beat the Lakers 105-103. The Phoenix Suns have only lost one game at home this season, and this man is why. Last night's example, 25 points, 16 rebounds, and 12 assists for Charles Barkley. He also scores high on the entertainment value. The final, Phoenix 131, Atlanta 119. My turn to call timeout, so you can look at all of last night's action on our scoreboard. For you. You won't see this Blackhawk logo on the University of North Dakota jerseys or caps next season. UND officials say uniforms bearing the Blackhawk symbol, like those of the hockey, basketball, and baseball teams, will be worn until the end of this season, but after that, the Indian Head logo will be totally phased out. But the transition in uniforms won't be as difficult on the athletic department as you might think.
Phasing out of the Blackhawk will require, most notably, certainly a change in our hockey uniform. And there are a few other minor things that will have to happen as well. I believe the basketball uniforms have a small patch on them, our baseball caps, but those are annual purchases anyway from the baseball perspective. So in that respect, it's kind of a minor issue in terms of what we'll actually have to do to replace the use of the Blackhawk as we've done in the past.
This logo will replace the Blackhawk head as the main Fighting Sioux logo after this season. And after current inventories run out, the UND bookstore will also stop selling any merchandise with the Blackhawk logo. Well, the UND ticket office has stopped selling tickets to this weekend's double whammy of a basketball game because they're sold out. The men's and women's teams take on rival NDSU this weekend. We'll talk with women's coach Gene Roebuck in a few minutes, but as Studio One sports reporter Brian McKenty tells us, all the men in Saturday night's battle have something to prove.
With arch rival North Dakota has delivered the upset.
Upset is right. The last time these two teams met, NDSU, picked to finish last in the NCC preseason poll, knocked off the Sioux, ranked ninth in the country in the same poll. What happened?
That score is deceiving. It was a 4 or 5 point game, and we hit our free throws down the stretch. They were forced to foul us, and they had to, and you know, we made our free throws, but that wasn't indicative of how tight a game it really was.
We just did not play well, and they played very well. We tippy-toed around, missed a lot of shots, and it was just one of those nights when things did not go well.
While both teams say that personal rivalries do develop on the floor, the players respect each other and get along off the court. Most players say the rivalry has more to do with the interstate nature of the games.
You know, they're only 70 miles away, interstate rivalry, and good tradition at both schools. And you know, you pack the houses each year, and it just builds up every year.
They're in-state, and everybody wants to know who's better. It's just like in the football.
UND forward Todd Johnson says the Sioux have to win two of their remaining three games to clinch second place in the NCC. So, despite all the media hype and fan hoopla about state bragging rights, second place is the priority. Or is it?
We just want to knock them off. That's all there is to it. We want to beat them and prove that, you know, we are the best team in North Dakota because we are. And we just didn't prove that last time we played them.
With conference placings and national tournament rankings on the line, and only three games left, the Sioux need every win they can get. A showdown with the Bison at Hislop should provide all the incentive they need. Now, what's the game plan, Todd?
Try and blow them out if we can.
With photographer Jake Henningsgaard, this is Brian McKinty for Studio One Sports.
If you don't have tickets for the game yet and you're planning on attending, you better be sure to get there early,
exactly.
It sounds like.
They're sold out and you have to get there early in walk-up sales. And it's first come, first serve. If you get there late, tough noogies, I guess. Coming up after a break, UND women's coach Gene Roebuck will join us to share his battle plans for Saturday's matchup with NDSU. But first, a look at what else is going on around the area this weekend. Please stay with us.
Banks concentrate on many things, like how many branches it can add or how big it can get. But at Community National Bank, we concentrate on our community and you. So we're ready to help when your car decides that today is its last day. At Community National Bank, we always want to be in the position to do whatever it takes to help you out the day you need us. Like today, maybe. Community National Bank, the bank that cares about you.
The 1986-87 women's basketball team weathered a rough season, compiling a record of just 7 wins and 20 losses. But the following year, with basically the same squad, the team finished in the NCAA Division II playoffs with a 22-6 record. The main difference between those two seasons, our next guest, Gene Roebuck, who took over as head coach of the women's basketball program in 87, has never had a losing season or even a season with more than 9 losses, and he joins us on our show. Gene, thanks for coming on the show.
My pleasure.
How do you turn a program around so quickly? You come in, step in, and immediately you're in the playoffs.
Well, one of the things that happened, I came from Lake Region Community College, UND Lake Region as it's called right now. Dreen Heisler came along with me, excuse me, and also Colleen Chasky. And I think two positions that you have to be good at are the point guard and the low post. And we pretty much filled those needs with Colleen and Dreen.
And as a coach, you're constantly rebuilding, but yet you've never had a losing season. Why is that?
Well, the University of North Dakota sells itself academically, and you're able to recruit quality student athletes. And you know, when you have a great university such as the University of North Dakota, you're able to attract not only good students but the good athletes too.
Darcy Deutsch, we're seeing some video of her. She's one of those, like you said, an important point guard.
Well, Darcy, I think, is one of the best point guards that we've had here at UND. She controls the tempo of the game. She distributes the ball really well, and I think she's the quickest player in the league right now.
She's very, as a senior, I imagine, she kind of helps out that way on and off the court.
Well, she's a leader, and, you know, I coached excuse me, I'm fighting a little bit
right.
of cold here, but I coached Darcy when she was a sixth grader, and she's always been one of the top competitors that you're going to find, and just a great person. If you tell her to do something, she's going to do it for the good of the team, and we're happy to have her. You know, she leads us by example, basically.
Another player who stands out is that everybody probably noticed, even just reading the box score, Sherry Kleinsasser. What kind of a player, and what does she do for you?
Well, first of all, Sherry's just a sophomore, and I think her better years are ahead of her, and she's having a great year right now. She's really kicked up her intensity, in the conference right now, and she's got probably the softest touch that I've coached around the basket. She's got a great vertical, about 25 inches, gets off her feet real quick, and one-on-one, I think she's pretty much unstoppable, but as of lately, she's been getting double-teamed, and she's still able to score 17 to 20 points a night.
Even as a sophomore, that's pretty impressive.
That's great.
This weekend's rivalry, let's get to the meat of the matter. The polls are all out, they say, number two versus number five and all that kind of things. What does this matchup do for you just as a coach?
It scares me.
Really?
Well, I don't know. I think it's a great matchup. It's just a great rivalry when you have year in and year out, UND and NDSU are ranked in the top 10 in women's basketball. I think it promotes women's athletics more than anything because we pack the place. I know we play with the men this weekend, but down at NDSU, the place was packed. And, it's just a great rivalry. Plus, there's a lot on this game. I mean, we can get a share of the conference title with winning this game and then winning the rest of our games. So I think the impact of this game is going to be greater than I think any other game that I've been in when we played NDSU.
Coach, thanks for joining us
today.
Thank you. I appreciate it. All right. Good luck this weekend. Not that you'll need it, but take it anyway. Well, coming up, torrential tropical rainstorms are forecast for a Midwestern U.S. city for the next decade, but residents aren't going to be headed for higher ground. We'll explain when we come back.
That's my dad. And that's Mom. Dad's got an idea. A way to get rid of all the grody garbage that's polluting the world. He's invented a big rocket ship to shoot all the garbage into outer space. Mom's not sure, but Dad says his invention will save the world.
There's an easier way to save the world. Recycle for your free recycling action guide, right? Recycle, Environmental Defense Fund, 257 Park Avenue South, New York, New York.
If you can't use force to stop a friend from drinking and driving,
hop in.
Use your wits.
This is your car.
Yeah.
My brother had the same car. He never let me drive it, though.
No?
So you must have had me in mind when you bought this. Wait till he hears you've got the same one, and you let me drive it, right?
Okay. Yeah.
Take the keys, call a cab, take a stand. Friends don't let friends drive drunk.
Here's one time it doesn't matter who your neighbor is. Here's the other. Life's too short. Stop the hate.
When you think of Cleveland, you probably think of a grungy Lake Erie port or a last place baseball team. It's the last place you'd think would be home to more than 600 different animals and 7,000 plants. As Studio One producer Kathleen Donnelly shows us, it's the place to be if you're an animal lover.
The Cleveland Metro Parks has added a unique exhibit to their zoo. It is called the Rainforest, and it is the home to 600 animals and over 7,000 plants. This atrium sets a tone of discovery as visitors enter the facility. The exhibits are designed to immerse visitors in learning through a variety of experiences. For example, the rainforest lets you experience a realistic tropical rainstorm, a 25-foot waterfall, and all the natural sounds of a tropical rainforest. rainforest has an authentic jungle research outpost that provides an overall setting for the exploration of the rainforest. Steve Taylor, director of the Cleveland Metro Park Zoo, tells us why this facility is so important and why we should care.
Well, saving the rainforest is one of our most important environmental issues. It affects the air we breathe, but biodiversity. You know, 50% of all the animals on Earth live in 6% of the Earth's surface, and that's the rainforest. Tremendous biodiversity. Some of the drugs we use for medicines are from the rainforest, and we've really explored very little of it. And the more we know, the more we're going to find out more useful plants and animals.
The 87,000 square foot addition expects to increase its audience to well over 1 million visitors a year. More importantly, however, the exhibit increases public awareness of the value of the rainforest and why we need to save it. For Studio One, this is Kathleen Donnelly reporting.
The zoo also features a video theater and 80-degree temperatures all year round. Coming up next, the a cappella sounds of the Nylons will knock your socks off, so stay with us.
Guess the mic, and we're going live in 10 seconds. Ready to dissolve to 2? Cue.
Children are the largest group of Americans living below the poverty line. They have to reach higher for what others take for granted. Health care, balanced meals, encouragement to learn. But with help early on, children in your community can gain the skills to get out from below the poverty line. It takes programs like Success by Six and people like you to help them take the first step. Call to learn more. Change the world of a child, and you change the world.
Protects all living things in the forest. But he can't do it alone. Please don't play with matches. Put out your campfires. And never, ever forget the words of Smokey Bear.
Only you can prevent forest fires.
Today's top 40 music charts are dotted with hits from groups like Boyz II Men and others that don't include any instrumental music. They only include voices of the group and maybe a drum track. This is what's known as a cappella. Before Boyz II Men were the Nylons. Over their 11 years of jamming without much accompaniment, they've had 8 different members. We had the chance to talk to number 8, Billy Newton Davis, and asked him why he decided to join one of the original a cappella groups.
The history of the group starts in Toronto, and there are 8 Nylons that have gone in and out of this group. I believe that they started on Spadina, a little, you know, a street in Toronto, and they started doing this doo-wop stuff, and then they started singing at parties, and then it became a phenomenon, and I feel that they were pushed, because I'm a new member, so I'm giving you some history that I'm sort of sure of and not sort of sure of.
Someone to call home, in a world ever-changing, here I am, stop where you're standing, what you need is a lover. A man to take over. Oh, girl, don't look any further.
Being that I was a solo artist before, I think originality is very, very important. And when the music is coming from you, it just makes it so much richer and so much better. And it also joined us, the four of us together, in having the originality where we could do something that we did and that we created. I mean, we sit there and we arrange and work this stuff along with producers and arrangers and stuff, but we are the core of it. And the originality, I think, is very, very important in any kind of music situation. CD Live to Love, it sounds like a lot of music, but it's our voices. Everything is tailored to the voice. The vocal pads are piano pads, our guitar pads. Everything is built from the music, but we're still doing it with our voice. And I mean, you know, the thing that I think we thought of this time was to free Arnold up, maybe, on some of the bass stuff, because Arnold has such a phenomenal voice. There was a bunch of guys who I think were like cabaret performers, and it started like a cabaret thing, and it just blew up into this whole big phenomena of, you know, a cappella.
The Nylons' latest release, Live to Love, is just out on Scotty Brothers Records. And Kim, you know, when I was putting that together, I kind of got into the music. I'm more of a rock and roller type of guy, but I really actually enjoyed putting that piece together.
They really seem to have a wide variety of fans,
especially
too.
In Canada and yeah. Up northern parts.
Yeah. Still to come on Studio One, Black Student Association President Olga James will join us to talk about some of the latest multicultural issues.
And a behind-the-scenes look of National Lampoon's Loaded Weapon 1 when
Can
we continue.
I'm giving her all she's got, Captain. If I push it any harder, the whole thing will blow.
Give me a name. Weren't your parents supposed to do that?
No, I look like an idiot. Are you kidding?
You're going to be better than me, Christopher. I can see it in your eyes. No wasting your life on something you hate. Not for my son. You're going to college. I can see it in your eyes.
I can see it in your eyes. You are going to do something important.
Christopher, time for work.
We've always had the dreams. Now we have the means. Please, support the United Negro College Fund.
Late one night in Calabasas.
Every week for the past 4 years, Stephanie has read stories to a room full of Savannah, Georgia preschoolers. Every week, the look on the children's faces is priceless. The love that Stephanie feels from every child has made her life a whole lot brighter. Even though Stephanie has never even seen their faces. To see how you can help in your community, call the Points of Light Foundation. Do something good. Feel something real.
To Victor, this isn't just a drawing, it's a cry for help. Listen to the children. Learn to protect them from drugs and violence. Call now and take a bite out of crime.
Thank you.
Welcome back to our second half hour of Studio One for this February 19th, 1993. We've passed all the major holidays in February, but there's another one coming up, Education Day. You may not know about it.
Yeah, Higher Education Day, a week from today. Got some more on that in the news coming up.
Students going down to Bismarck to talk about tuition and stuff like that. More news coming up. Well, coming up, did you know that February is also Black Culture History Month? Here at the University of North Dakota, Olga James and the Black Student Association are bringing in some events to create awareness of the month-long celebration. She'll tell us what those are, as well as discuss some of the issues facing multiculturalism.
Also in store for you, Dr. David Hunnicut has been working with universities, corporations, and state agencies to increase awareness of alcohol abuse. He also has found a lethal link between alcohol and the transmission of the AIDS virus. He'll join us with the details.
All that and a lot more coming up, but first, Jennifer has the news headlines.
U.S. Coast Guard cutters are helping recover the bodies of victims of a ferry boat disaster off the coast of Haiti. The Neptune sank with as many as 1,000 people on board. 285 survivors were rescued. One said stormy seas tossed the ferry from side to side and knocked people overboard. The ferry was on a 120-mile journey from Jeremie to Port-au-Prince when it sank. Many of the survivors were in the water for more than 12 hours before they were rescued. A major storm system is soaking the Pacific coast. Several homes in the Los Angeles area were damaged by a mudslide. High winds toppled trees and power lines in Santa Barbara last night. A winter storm warning is in effect for higher elevations. More rain is expected in Southern California today. Tuition is going up at UND next year. That doesn't surprise many people. But UND's student government is helping to surprise some North Dakota legislators. The student government office is sponsoring a bus trip to Bismarck on Higher Education Day next Friday. The trip will give students a chance to voice their opinions to lawmakers. UND's student body president Maria Efforts says they hope to show legislators that students are concerned.
We are a powerful force. We are paying your taxes. We are paying tuition. We make a difference. Listen to us a little bit. And hopefully we can make an impact on some of the legislators, realizing that we do play an important part in North Dakota's economic growth and their system.
Students from all over the state will travel to the Capitol. Interested students can contact campus student government offices. North Dakota has long been known for its grain and livestock production, but a Farmers Home Administration grant may allow the state another distinction. The FHA approved a $250,000 grant for a new aquaculture facility to be built in Carrington, North Dakota. The facility's main purpose is to research and develop fish farming in the state. The aquaculture facility will be unique to the Northern Plains. Officials believe North Dakota fish farmers could produce as much as 10 million pounds of fish annually. The facility will be built adjacent to the Carrington Research Extension Center. Construction is expected to begin this spring. One man has given up raising wheat and cattle and turned to trolling in the new waters of fish farming in the state. He's hoping others will get hooked on his crop. Tom Gerhardt takes us to one of North Dakota's first commercial fish farms.
There isn't a wheat field in this old lumberyard building. If you step inside, you'll find fish. And Mark Willows will introduce you to a different type of farming.
This here is a what they call a blue tilapia. These fish originate over in Africa. And this one here, we got out of Florida about 5-6 months ago.
Willows feeds the fish regularly and keeps the room temperature near 80 degrees. He says fish farming is the wave of the future because people demand healthy foods and quality.
One of our biggest selling points is how fresh this product is. We process one morning and that same afternoon it's on an airplane to London. That evening they're served in it can be within 24 hours or so.
Willows sells his fish in and out of the state.
We've shipped fish into New Orleans, Chicago, Minneapolis, Denver. We've shipped fish over to the Hilton and the Marriott over in London.
Willows says using the tilapia provides a number of advantages.
It grows real well on commercial feed. It tolerates high densities. You know, you can pack a lot of fish in a tank full of water, and they seem to do real well.
If his business works, the blue tilapia may turn gold, and North Dakota may turn into a fish farming state. With photographer Craig Troutman, Tom Gerhardt, Studio One News.
The fish are also processed and packaged in Binford, North Dakota. Wilson says the fish grown on his farm are raised in a chemical-free environment. And a lot of people may not know it, but Governor Ed Schaefer also has a fish farm, so.
I guess opponents of the governor can insert your own fish joke here, but we won't touch it. Thanks, Jennifer. Well, if Science of the Lambs was too gory for you and Lethal Weapon series was a little too violent, National Lampoon's newest picture might be for you. Their latest effort stars Emilio Estevez in a comical caper about two cops who are trying to solve a crazy case. Here's a sneak peek at Loaded Weapon 1.
What's wrong?
Nothing. Sorry.
So you let him get away, huh?
The hardest part of doing this movie is trying to keep a straight face for both of us.
Namaste.
Excuse me.
Yes, sir.
Do you have any of these in taupe?
No taupe, beef jerky.
And you call this a convenience store?
I am Mr.
Open up the cash register, I'll splatter your brain.
Take it easy.
Excuse me.
These guzzballs mind if I join in?
Definitely trying to solve a case.
Hey, what you got, Sarge?
Nothing solid. You got any theories?
E equals MC squared.
It's a very challenging role for me.
Did I come in a bad time?
As far as not laughing during the takes.
You sleep in the nude?
Only when I'm naked.
Don't ever sound.
The hell?
General. How's your health, Mike?
I'm just having a bull, basically.
You say try and take it a holiday? We'll take again! What the hell you want, Luger?
I want the York case.
There's no York case! It was a suicide! Copy?
No thanks.
Cappuccino? Espresso? Hey, Scotty! Can you get this machine to work?
I'm giving it all she's got, Captain. If I push it any harder, the whole thing will blow.
Give me a name. Weren't your parents supposed to do that?
I look like an idiot. Are you kidding? Look at me. I didn't have this much hair when I had hair.
Give it to me straight. Is this it, the big checkout?
You'll be back on your feet in no time.
There are things that have to happen that people are waiting to see happen, and we seriously follow through the motions, and there are a lot of funny things that happen around this serious situation.
So, this is Mr. Screw with your brain, eat your spleen, wear your flesh as a hairnet leecher, huh? Well, look who's Mr. Scaredy Pants now.
Identification, please.
It's a fun movie. It's not going to change anybody's life. I think right now, with the state of the country, the state of the nation, right now, we need movies that offer escapism and will allow us to laugh. I just gotta ask, what does human flesh taste like?
chicken.
I know. Don't thank me. Just a cop doing his job.
For Black Student Association President Olga James and talk about some of the issues facing multiculturalism. Stay with us.
Today, banks concentrate on many things, like how many branches it can add or how big it can get. But at Community National Bank, we concentrate on our community and you. So we're ready to help when your car decides that today is its last day. At Community National Bank, we always want to be in the position to do whatever it takes to help you out the day you need us. Like today, maybe. Community National Bank, the bank that cares about you.
Good it felt the first time you gave five? Well, now there's another way to give five. Set a goal to give more. 5 hours a week and 5% of your income to the causes you care about. It'll make you feel like a winner every day of your life. So give more. Give five. Call 1-800-55-GIVE-5.
Well, our next guest is concerned about the harmony between all the different cultures, not only on UND campus, but around the world, so much so that she took over the presidency of the Black Student Association in just her second year on campus. Olga James, a sophomore going into medical technology, but she researches more than just doctor's instruments. She looks back into the histories of Afro-Americans. Olga, thanks for joining us today.
Thanks for having me, Chris.
I guess February, Black Culture Month, people hear it. What are you trying to draw attention to? Is there anything specific?
It's that idea of a community outreach. We're in Grand Forks, and we feel that there is a need to have people delve into other cultures, learn about different people. For us, for the BSA specifically, for instance, we have a Dayton's Cookout. It's a community outreach program. Food is something that is international, and I think that with going to Dayton's, cooking specific foods from different places in the South Caribbean, that's a way of getting people to entice them to kind of come in, to have a bit of food, question, why does it taste like this, why is it like that? And
so you're kind of teaching through something that's actually fun.
Right, exactly. Kind of people get a full stomach, they walk away happy, learning something.
Exactly. Well, in one event you had like a mock debate between Martin Luther King and Malcolm X, imposters. I guess
imposters.
Imposters. They were imposters. They
weren't
the
right
real people. What did these two differ on the most, and what did they agree on the most?
Actually, I think they were more alike than they were dissimilar. And what happened at that debate, which was a good outcome, it brought people in, and it was in an area and a situation where people asked questions, and they didn't feel hindered to ask questions. And to put it in a nutshell, they wanted the unification of people of color, first of all, because in order for that to happen, for people of color to get along with people who are not of color, it was important for them to unite amongst themselves first before they could go forth. And that was the main focus, just for unity, for people to get along.
Okay.
That kind of ideology.
One of the hot topics in education these days is making culture diversity classes a required part of the curriculum.
Definitely.
And some people, and there's a viewpoint out there that some people say this is a great idea, but it's not financially possible. What do you say to the people who have that kind of an opinion? What can you say back to them?
What do I say back to them? I think anything is financially possible. I think it's in the mind of how much you want that to happen. There are many things that happen that are not, I think, on the forefront of importance, but they happen. And I think just that idea, if you really want something to happen, there are always ways of making that happen. And I think, for instance, right now, President Clinton is doing things like that right now.
That's a great attitude. Olga, thanks for coming on today. I appreciate
Thanks for having me.
All right.
Okay.
Well, coming up, is there a link between alcohol and AIDS? Dr. David Hunnicut will answer that and many more questions when Studio One continues. Stay right here.
And we're going live in 10 seconds. Ready to dissolve to 2? Cue.
Excuse me, do you wear your safety belt?
Why, no, I don't wear my safety belt.
Thank you.
You could learn a lot from a dummy. Buckle your safety belt.
This is where I live. There are lots of doctors and machines for me and the other kids. Last week, a guy named Mike came. He took us all on a camping trip.
Mike gives up a weekend a month to help a disabled child, but he gets back a feeling that lasts forever.
When I get better, you know what? I'm gonna take Mike fishing.
To find out what you can do in your community, call the Points of Light Foundation. Do something good. Feel something real.
Adolescent alcohol consumption is a bigger risk now than ever before. Consequences from the use of alcohol not only involve accidents, injury, and violence, but a lethal link with AIDS. The Director of Education for the Alcoholism and Drug Abuse Council of Nebraska is Dr. David Hunnicut, and he joins us to share some of his research and ideas on that link. Dr. Hunnicut, thank you for joining us today. First of all, what is the link between AIDS and alcohol, and who is at risk these days?
That's an interesting question. You know, being in the alcohol abuse prevention field, we've been reading about the traditional negative consequences that we've seen for the last 10 years on college campuses, throwing up, falling down, doing something stupid. Generally, it, you know, falls within those particular categories. But now we're beginning to see more research which suggests an interesting hypothesis, which suggests that increased alcohol use might increase the risk for HIV infection. Here's the hypothesis, and again, this is a preliminary kind of research piece that we're beginning to see more of. It suggests that when an individual gets intoxicated, it increases the likelihood of unplanned intercourse. It decreases the likelihood of condom use and increases the likelihood of multiple partners over time. What that translates into is if you take a look at the alcohol use of college students, approximately 80% of college students drink, 50% of those students binge drink. Now, when you take a look at the sexual behaviors of college students, approximately 80% are sexually active. 50% have two or more partners within any given year, and about two-thirds of that is unprotected sex. So what it boils down to is an individual, and we're taking a look at the college campus primarily here, is an individual who abuses alcohol runs the risk, and we're not sure why that risk is there, of perhaps increasing the risk for HIV infection.
Okay. What are the statistics on adolescents and college students who are HIV positive or have AIDS?
Presently, and we don't have good databases in place on college campuses. Now, we have better databases when it comes to alcohol use, but this is a brand new phenomenon. Mm-hmm. The studies that we have read suggest the estimate of HIV positive individuals on campus is about 2.5 per 1,000. Now, that doesn't seem like an alarming number to many, and I'm not sure whether that's cause for concern or not. However, we don't have a benchmark for what constitutes a safe number of HIV, you know, positive people on campus. We're not really sure.
Mm-hmm. What should people know about being tested for AIDS? What steps should be taken?
If you feel that you are at risk and have engaged in any high-risk activities, then testing is certainly a viable option, and we would encourage that. There are several issues when it comes to testing, and unfortunately, given the new nature of this particular disease, we haven't worked out all of the political ramifications of HIV testing. The recommendation right now, as I understand it, is that if an individual is interested in getting tested, they get tested at a public health clinic, the reason being confidentiality. Right now, insurance companies are extremely wary of insuring anyone who may be potentially HIV positive. Even if an individual gets an HIV test and it returns negative, that still could trip a red flag for insurance companies. So the recommendation to be on the safe side is not to get tested through your physician, but rather to get tested through a public health clinic where the test results can remain anonymous.
Dr. Hunnicut, you seem to have such a passion for this topic. What made you decide to research this and lecture about it?
Well, generally, my interest was in health promotion and working with companies and corporations. One of the things that we kept finding in American business is that a leading healthcare cost was alcoholism treatment. Consequently, many businesses are interested in reducing some of their risks, and they're asking to say, well, where does the problem begin? And they pointed primarily to the college campus because they recruit so heavily on the college campus. Well, we find that the behaviors are well rooted and have been a part of the college campus for years. However, drinking begins long before students ever set foot on campus. Matter of fact, the onset of use is about 12 years of age.
Okay, in your lecture last night, you had said something that I thought was really interesting. You said that the common campus model was that good judgment comes from experience and experience comes from poor judgment. What exactly did you mean by that?
Well, generally, we have a tendency in this country to learn through experience. Let's say, for example, that if I'm a freshman from a small town or any given community and I step on campus and I've never used alcohol before, that I may go out to one of the local soirees, for lack of a better term, and let's say I have three beers in a half an hour. And I felt great, so I thought I'd feel twice as good if I had three beers in the next half hour. Unfortunately, I'm inexperienced with alcohol, and now I'm intoxicated, and it leads to a variety of negative consequences. Unfortunately, we continue to experience those negative consequences, and college students, by the time they graduate or by the time they turn 30, whichever happens first, they're generally responsible drinkers because they've experienced every negative consequence known to mankind. The problem with this particular model is it's extremely inefficient, and when you take a look at the fact of sexual consequences, it becomes of major concern.
Okay. Dr. Hunnicut, thank you so much for joining us today.
My pleasure.
Stay with us. We'll be right back. I'm sorry. I was trying to get your agenda.
During the Gulf War, alongside our full-time troops, stood another important group of people, the men and women of the National Guard and Reserve. In fact, they make up over 44% of our nation's defense. It makes you wonder where we would be without them. When your employees need time off to serve, be a hero. Give them the freedom to protect ours.
Boy, I really did it last night. Got drunk, acted stupid, went home with... Who is that? What, am I stupid? How did I do this? Barry began to worry, really worry. What about AIDS? Then he remembered, hey, I'm just a cartoon. I don't even have to shower. Get high, get stupid, get AIDS.
We are out of time. Thanks for joining us this week. We'll be back next week at the same time in the same place. We hope to see you here too. Now we'll leave you with another look at the Nylons and their music video. Don't look any further. Until next time, take care.
No, me get the understand, say you are look for a man. But this is not a rap, it's like an application from the one Mr. Monroe Band Jamaican. With the loving on my heart and the mic in my hand. So when it comes to loving, I'm a champion. Phenomenon, one the diggity done for your satisfaction. Forget some ragamuffin, loving all night strong. No bother, look no further if you want action.
Tonight, tonight,
I'm gonna taste a little
My,
don't look any further, no.
should you come round, don't look no further.
Oh,
my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day, oh, my day,